left, right, left, right, left, right, left, right, left.
What are you doing here? That's all I have to say. Sorry. About 1961, I began to photograph jazz musicians in New York. And very often in clubs, you would find a microphone like this. And I'll bet if we look at one photograph in this book, we find one of those microphones. We should look and see.
Okay. This is a photograph of Ben Webster playing tenor saxophone with Major Holly on bass. And it was taken at a club at 155th Street and St. Nicholas Terrace. And I'd forgotten the name of the club. And the house band for the club was basically Ram Ramirez, who wrote the tune that Billie Holiday recorded called Lover Man, recorded by many other people afterwards. Although there was some controversy about exactly what he did, because there are three people listed as writing the tune, but he always said that he wrote it, so there we go. And oddly enough, he was living in a building at 33rd Street and 2nd Avenue, and I was in need of a new apartment. I had to move, and I moved into a place which was really horrible. And he sent the agent for the house to me one day, and I signed a lease, and I moved into the same building that he was living in at 33rd Street and 2nd Avenue. And the rent was $43.33 a month at the time. This was a club that was in really deep Harlem. But some really interesting people played there. I mean, Mel Lewis was on drums on one set of things that I photographed there. But I photograph Webster fairly often, and sometimes I would go back to his hotel, which is the Forest Hotel on 50th Street and just off Broadway, where there were a lot of musicians staying. And I would just go back to his room, and he would usually take his clothes off, get into pajamas, and go to bed and tell stories. So.
If I think about 1961, I think of the moment when I really started to think about the potential of the electric guitar and maybe electricity in general. One of the popular musics of that time was guitar instrumental music, twangy guitar instrumental music. And it seemed very futuristic. The guitars looked very futuristic. And often the music was about exotic places, space travel, very atmospheric music. And I was just beginning to think about playing the guitar at that time. And so it was incredibly appealing. And the first tune I learned to play on the guitar was called Apache, a recording by the Shadows. And Apache was, it dovetailed with another thing I was fascinated by, which was Westerns. Westerns were a big thing when I was growing up, 50s and early 60s. And I loved Westerns, because there was something about Westerns that was about wilderness and just expansive country. And somehow this fashion for twangy guitar music picked up on the drama, both the drama and the expansiveness of Westerns. So it imprinted something in my mind about guitars. And really that's something that I think has stayed with me ever since. And over time I started to play different instruments. By the late 80s, 87, I was composing music on a computer. I was writing and I needed word processing, and so I bought an Atari computer which had MIDI ports, so I could use it for music as well. And I was very inspired at that time by the experimental house tracks and techno tracks that were being released coming out of Detroit and Chicago. And by 1989, I was writing my own techno tracks. And in a way, they had that same kind of feeling of exotic places, space travel, expansive landscapes. To me, they're an extension of the kind of thing that had first inspired me to play music. That music was an incredible way to create imaginary places. And even though the means of creating that music was very different between guitar and computer, it was a very strong link for me in the way they made the impossible possible.
for a fire or a sandman, arc of ice for a mad key of glass, suddenly a half look, a half look. Of course, does not keep people free.
Thank you.